exclusive movie reviews podcast. Today I'm joined by our illustrious co-host, Mr. Mike. How are you doing, Mr. Mike?
Good. How about you, not co-host? What did you classify yourself as the other day? You're like...
So in order to be a co-host, I think you have to know something. You have to be smart. Unfortunately, for legal reasons, anything I've ever said is a joke. So I don't think that qualifies me to be the co-host of anything. So you guys are all a co-host. I am just the court jester, maybe. Maybe I'm the court jester. I don't know. Just going to get my hat with the bells on. I'll jump around. Well, hey, unfortunately, we didn't have a fun movie to review this week. It was not on the gesture side of things. It was kind of more on the whole world-ending side. But we got through it, and...
Would one say we got through the apocalypse?
The apocalypse? What?
The X-Men apocalypse?
The X-Men apocalypse? No way. Yeah, we watched X-Men Apocalypse. For all of you, though, all of you playing at home, playing along with us at home? I don't
watching
know.
Along?
Probably isn't anyone actually watching these movies with us because, you know, nobody watches these. But that's okay because we like wearing it. It's fun. Yay. All right. X-Men Apocalypse is a, 2014 movie? I didn't look it up. 2016. All right. That's when I was guessing the graphics were about 2014 or so. So I was off by 2 years. But it was kind of recent and definitely one of the huge blockbuster CGI things. Mr. Mike, what did you rate this out of 8?
I would say, oh goodness, I totally forgot what I gave Days of Future Past. Did I give that like a 6 or 7? I'd probably give this one like a 5. The visuals are, I'd say, exemplary in how creative they get, especially, again, we get the return of Quicksilver, so we get some fun shenanigans with those. I think that's probably the highlight of the movie is Quicksilver again.
Yes, Quicksilver.
But
100%.
I'd say in terms of story, I don't know. Watching it again, I was just like, eh. Should I even care? Like, there's a lot of like loose ends that either they don't tie up or they try tying up and it doesn't tie up well. And it's like, eh. So yeah, I'd say 5. Not giving it like a failing grade if you're thinking about 5 out of 8 or anything like that. But
yeah,
no. What about you, Nick?
So before I rate that, I need to ask you: did we miss anything? Because I know that we're kind of dancing around the X-Men universe, and the biggest pet peeve I have in all of cinema, they did it in Star Wars, they almost did it in the MCU, and I think they might have done it here. Did we miss anything like major? Like, I don't know, hinting at this apocalypse dude?
Nope. We missed nothing. This is basically a direct sequel to Days of Future Past. Not like right after Days of Future Past, but I'd say
10 years later.
Yeah. Something around that.
I think 10 years later. Well, then unfortunately, seeing how I didn't miss a movie that set this dude up, I'm going to have to give this a 3 out of 8. I'm sorry, guys. I really hate it when a movie takes the first 10 minutes to establish a villain that was somehow bigger and worser than the last all of the villains because they ran out of villains to do. And it just really sucks that like no one had the forethought to like hint at it. They did it with Palpatine. You know, it was kind of like, oh,
somehow
wow.
Palpatine's back.
Episode 9, Palpatine's back. Ooh. Poor writing. That is dumb. Don't do that if you write movies for a living, because that's just, it's like, all right, you have all of the heroes and the anti-heroes getting together and fighting against the main villain, the little short guy who I can't remember his name, but he was famous and played the big dude from the other one. Anyway, that guy from the last movie. And they all fight and they all have character arcs, right? But then they're all completed at that end, at the end of that movie, Days of Future Past. And then we move on to Apocalypse, the next X-Men movie. And the writers, I just imagine the writers sitting in the writer's room and they're just looking at each other like, so now what? We almost had the world nuke each other. What could be worse than that? And then they're like, what if we just literally bring in Satan to this?
What
and
if
then
we literally like, just oh, fire okay. all the nukes? So that way we can't fire any more nukes.
Exactly. Like, that's how nukes work, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
What did you think of that scene? They're just like, you know what? We launched nukes in the first one, so let's just launch all the nukes, and they explode in the air, so that way nothing happens with the nukes.
I mean, from a pure story perspective, I think it's kind of interesting to see that Xavier has the power to like control all those people without the whatever machine. Like, that's kind of cool story.
Without Cerebro,
yeah. But without outside of how space works? That's not how space works. Like, I'm sorry. These missiles have pre-programmed, at least in the 80s, they had pre-programmed destination points. The little guys just set 1 through 5, basically, on which target they were targeting. There wasn't an option just to go up. And also, that's not how space works. What comes up must come down unless you go up and sideways really fast and attain orbital velocity. So, unfortunately, all of those nukes would come crashing down, which is totally fine. Because, contrary to popular belief, nukes do not spontaneously combust on impact. Almost all of them are designed to not do that. So even if you do blow up a nuke with either a chemical, you know, traditional weapon, or even drop it from a great height, like, say, whatever the apoplexy of that crazy trajectory was, they would just shatter into pieces and not blow up. So basically, I hated that whole part of the movie, but... yeah.
I like the biblical references that they had Oscar Isaac kind of say as Apocalypse. Like, he mentions at that very specific scene, like, the Tower of Babel. I'm like, wow, we're taking it real back.
Yeah. Yeah, no, definitely. There's tons of religious and biblical tie-ins, for sure.
Oh, my goodness. Every single scene with Apocalypse.
Trying to, like, hype him up to be, like... okay. Like, if they did it a little bit, I probably would have been less critical about it. But, like, the whole point of this movie was, like, oh, by the way, there was this really big bad guy who, like, is literally, like, king of all of the mutant, like, powers. He can do anything, basically, except for telepathy, which he kind of does at the end there. He can do all of this, but we just forgot to mention it. Just, you know, so we'll take the first 3 minutes of this movie and explain that for you. And then you just have to buy into the premise that this dude's just been chilling in some dungeon all this time. Not dungeon, but, you know, whatever. Also, who designed that dumb pyramid back then? What the heck? Man. Was able to be taken down by, like, two bricks? Like, what?
Technically, if you watch the end of Days of Future Past, that end credit scene, it was Apocalypse who made that pyramid. So he made this system to where someone could sabotage the whole entire structure by knocking down a few logs of wood and just careening... giant blocks of stone at certain things and making things fall.
Why? And then also, like, the infinite falling scene where the lady with the force shield, I don't remember, kind of minor character from the beginning there, but she was, like, making a little force shield around the cocoon Apocalypse dude as he was falling down. It was like, that falling scene lasted at least 20 seconds, and I'm just sitting there like...
It was a really big shaft.
You're already underground. How big of a shaft is this supposed to be? And, like... I don't buy any of this, I'm sorry. And also, I know what you're doing, movie. You're trying to hype up this big bad guy who's really, like, just a dumb plot device. Ugh.
He's also powered by the sun via gold.
Yes. I love gold! Gold! Awesome gold powers. Is amazing. Yeah. Boy. Sorry, yeah, 3 out of 8. I think we're still on that part.
That's all right.
Review here.
That's all right.
It was not my favorite movie. I did regret watching it. I will not watch this movie again. But it was, the positives for it were definitely the graphics were headed in the right direction, especially all those scenes with Magneto at the end where, like, all of the little items were flying around. Like, they had like freeze frames that, like, I was pausing it and, like, taking a look, and, like, everything was well rendered and stuff.
What'd you think of that with all the magnetic fields that they kind of rendered around Magneto to kind of show, like, oh, look, he's, like, taking control of a whole bunch of magnetic fields, but, of course, like, it amounts to nothing besides, like, him making a whole bunch of damage around the world. Like, he destroys the Sydney Opera House for no good reason.
But he fixes it all later. Did you see them fix the... him and the telepathy lady, they fixed the...
they fixed the mansion.
Mansion, yeah, thank you.
Telepathy lady. Do you know who the telepathy lady is?
No,
it's Jean Grey.
It's not.
It's Raven. The lady who's been haunting Logan for the past, like, 3 films.
Haunting Logan.
Oh, so boy. You remember how in the Wolverine movie, he kept on dreaming of this red-haired lady, like, in his bed with him or whatever.
Okay, yeah. I thought that was his wife.
No, that's Jean Grey. Just some girlfriend that he had in the trilogy that we may or may not watch at some point in the future.
Okay. All right, cool. I don't need to know about that.
So that's
that,
young Jean Grey. So they've set up
okay.
young Jean Grey in this movie to kind of show, okay, like, hey, here she is kind of learning her powers, and then we get a little bit of a tease
at
the end.
And she's time traveling? She goes back to Logan?
No. This is just young Jean Grey. Like, this is almost like the origins of... So, like, how in First Class we kind of got the origins of Professor X and Magneto. Mm-hmm. This is kind of her... Not really origin movie, but it's more of her or the audience's introduction to her. Of, oh, this is Jean Grey. She's all powerful. And, of course, at the very end, you get to see Phoenix Force.
Almost. Is that what it's called?
Yeah.
I thought it was called Mary Sue Force, but, you know, whatever.
It's actually...
Sorry, that it all just kind of came out of nowhere. It's just like, oh, by the way, she's, like, way more powerful than Professor... Okay, that was... All right. Besides the dumb apocalypse dude, the biggest problem I had with the movie was that the answer to all of the hero's problems were, just try harder. It was like, oh, but I don't have control over the gazer beam knockoff guy, the guy with his eyeballs.
Scott Summers.
No, he died, didn't he?
No, that was Havoc. That was the other Summers.
The younger brother.
Oh, the older brother.
Okay.
Older brother died.
The guy with the cool sunglasses for most of the movie.
Scott Summers.
He was like, you know, I can't control it. And Mystique's just like, just reach deep and do it. And I'm just like, wow, I really wish it was that easy. I'm not very good at this skill. Just try harder. Oh, astute observation. Thank you.
I don't think it even was that. I think she said, like, just wreak havoc, or maybe not wreak havoc. It was more of a, just go for it. Yeah. Who cares? Like,
I know, like that. But like, same thing with what Apocalypse said to Professor X when he was trying to get him to not use the whatever thing you just said, the cerebral whatever.
Cerebral.
He's just like, it's within you. Just try it. And he's just like, oh, okay, and it just works. And then same with Magneto. The Apocalypse dude's just like, you can do anything, just do it. Don't listen to the evil humans. And then it's just like, oh, he can do anything now. And then it's like, really? Like, I don't know why.
I want to see
character development. I want to see characters have to, like, go through adversities to, like, learn their skills and train and, like, become better. But, like, in this movie, they're all just like, oh, I suck. I'm just a little student. Now I'm literally a powerful Phoenix lady who's going to save the day, which I'm glad she saved the day. Anyway, sorry.
Don't be sorry. There's a lot of shoehorning in this movie that I've noticed with trying to make Mystique like this hero to all mutants or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's like, I guess, kind of. And then, if this does take place like 10 years after Days of Future Past, Quicksilver hasn't aged a day, or at least he doesn't look like he has. Yeah. Even though he's like maybe in his 30s
still living
or something.
In his mom's basement.
Like, if he was like, I don't know, maybe 17 or 18 years old or something like that in Days of Future Past, and he's like 27 or 20, so he's around 30. He still hasn't confronted his dad. He still hasn't done a bunch of stuff. He's still kind of hanging out in his mom's basement.
Why didn't he confront his dad at the end there? I was like, dude. He's like, I'm here for family too. I'm like, we had all of this lead up and then you just drop it. Why? And I was really hoping to like have some redemption later. And at the end, he's just like, maybe I'll tell him at some point. You're just like, this is so painful. I don't know.
Yeah.
This was not my movie. Sorry.
Going a little bit more emotional, I guess. What did you think of the beginning of the movie with Eric defecting to, I guess, was it Pruskov, Russia? Or Pruskov, Russia, and he has finally a normal life, like being able to live like a normal human being, or at least not even a normal human being, but more of just have a normal life with a family, a wife and a kid, and then it all just gets taken away.
I really did like that. That was definitely one of the higher points of the movie, being able to show
the higher points.
I love good character arcs. Like, I love a good story where, like, you know, they take a character and do something interesting with them. And I think with Magneto, they did. They, like, okay, what happens after you try to, like, kill everybody in the White House? Well, guess what? Russia's going to be your new best friend. So you move there. Like, that's what happens. Ask Edward Snowden. You move to Russia and you start a family. And having him work at a steel mill was kind of cool. For the first few shots before I like figured out he was just pretending to be a normal guy, I was like, oh, he's going to be like over in the corner, just like doing everything floaty. But it's like, okay, this works. You know, he's trying to hide his powers and, They established, you know, the little daughter. Are they going to take you away from me? No, never. I'm like, yeah.
2 minutes later. I haven't
watched this movie, but totally, yeah. In about 10 minutes, you're going to be gone, dude. Something's happening here. Your kid's going to be gone. Obviously, I knew he was in. It can be at the end of the movie. Yeah, but anyway, so I was like, good character development with the family, good character development with Magneto, and obviously very noble cause for him to, you know, break his mask and, you know, save that dude and, you know, the thingy that fell. What was the earth shaking? Oh, was that?
It was because Apocalypse, because this is all set, like, this whole chain of events is all because Moira, this one character that maybe you forgot from First Class, but maybe she's a familiar face. She was the one U.S. agent lady who was helping out with Charles. Yeah.
CIA lady. Yeah.
The one who basically went into the dancing room in Las Vegas, if you remember that.
Uh-huh.
Same character. Anyways, this is all set up because she just so happenly found a secret entrance into the lost tomb of Apocalypse or whatever. And then just a little bit of sunlight gets through that tomb tunnel or whatever and hits the gold and awakens him. It's just like, because of that, Eric loses his family, almost commits a whole bunch more murder, and then gets taken back to Auschwitz to where Apocalypse is like, just do it. And Eric's like, I did it. And then destroys Auschwitz, totally. Which I don't know how to feel about that. My wife and I were watching. I'm like, is this good or bad that Auschwitz is being destroyed in like this X-Men universe? Like, it's good in regards to like a lot of terrible stuff happened there. But also, like, it's a historical place where you kind of want to preserve, maybe not preserve the memory, but preserve, like,
Don't forget it.
Don't
forget what led to this.
It's like the 9/11 memorial. Like, they have cool, really big, like, accurate pools, basically, that outline the perimeter of the buildings. And it's a great, fantastic memorial. It's very silent. When I've been there, you just feel really, it's really weird, but awesome. It's a fantastic feeling.
Yeah.
If you haven't gone to the 9/11 Memorial,
to Ground Zero,
go. It is
not since they did the park. I mean, I was there in 2007 and 2009.
It's beautiful.
They hadn't finished the
memorial. I was there, I think, the first month that they opened up the One World Trade and got to go up. But anyways, sidetracking. I don't know how to feel about Auschwitz being destroyed.
Yeah, I know. I have a similar feeling there. I was kind of like sitting there like, yeah, oh, yeah.
Yeah,
like, I don't know.
Good. Like, that place is terrible, but also, okay.
But I feel like this Apocalypse guy's about to do way worse. What are you doing, dude? It's like, yeah, go destroy Auschwitz and then like kill all the humans. Okay, yeah. Mm, lovely.
So you think Eric had probably a good story arc in this movie?
I think I like, out of all of the things here, Eric probably had the best story arc, and it was really only in that first 30 minutes or so after he kind of flipped. It was just like, all right, we're waiting for him to redeem himself. When is it going to happen? When's it going to happen? You know, whatever. But what I really did like was the scene where all the cops show up in the forest and he's like looking for his daughter. And then, you know, obviously, Arrow, for a while I was like, wait a minute, why the arrows? And I was like, oh yeah, metal. Got it. And he killed his wife and daughter in one shot because that guy is an expert bow marksman.
He wasn't even looking. Like, he's just like, bird.
He's like clean shot between, killed two people. Anyway, not good for Magneto, but, good shot for that guy. And then just watching Magneto just, that's terrible.
Anyone
that's
who plays terrible. Halo. Double kill. It's
terrible.
Triple kill.
Anyway, and just watching him deck everyone with just like a little pennant or whatever, I wasn't sure.
It's almost like a Yondu scene anyone's watched Guardians of the Galaxy.
Oh, yeah.
It's very similar. I didn't realize until I watched him, like, hey, it's just Yondu's arrow, but it's a pennant of Eric's mom and dad. That's kind of weird.
And I just love how it was the camera was focused on his face, like in rage and in sorrow and bitterness. And just watching all the bodies just drop in the background, it's just like, oh.
I think Michael Fassbender did a great job with acting in that scene. Like, I wouldn't say he deserves a Grammy, but it was a really great performance. And that's probably the...
Well, I'll have my Grammy bake him a pie.
Gosh, dang it. All right. Speaking of... There's another character I wanted to get your initial impressions on as well. Yeah. We're introduced to Nightcrawler in this movie. He's the purple demon-looking guy who actually is in the first trilogy, or first, the trilogy that we may or may not watch in the future of the X-Men movies, X-Men 1, 2, and 3. He's in that, but very different. I would say very different character in regards to this Nightcrawler. But what did you think of him as at least a new addition to kind of the X-Men universe and his powers? And who
I liked his powers for sure. Like I think there was that telepath guy who was the bad guy in what was it? Origins, I think. Anyway, the one was it Origins? Anyway, the bad guy demon dude.
Oh, who that was First Class.
First Class. Okay, yeah, First Class. That makes sense. But yeah, I kind of like that whole like just being able to phase in and phase out of places. Like that's a pretty fun power that writers can really play with and do pretty well. I think for Nightcrawler's character, they did a pretty good job as well, keeping the balance between like keeping it like slightly realistic. I get it's a huge superhero big battle movie, so I'm not looking for all of the physics to make sense, but you know, saying, you know, he can't go anywhere, he has to go somewhere he's seen or knows and has been before. And they definitely use his character quite a bit to speed up the plot. And I think that's how it all happens so condensely, because they're able to get characters all over the place real quick. So anyway, I definitely did. I guess his character more specifically, they did a good job setting him up. I think showing that mutants, 10 years after the White House, I don't know what they would call that event.
The White House event.
But, White House anomaly with Magneto from the last
movie. The stadium anomaly.
The stadium. I mean, we still call January 6th the Capitol. So, you know, it's like, well, all right, the White House that happened 10 years ago in this universe. So that thing, all of the humans don't like the mutants, right? And so, like, there's kind of this whole, like, seedy underworld of, like, kind of treating the mutants as fight night. Yeah, kind of just, like, kind of slaves. So it was definitely cool to see that character, and I think it was Angel, right? The guy who was in later in the movie, they were fighting. So it was kind of cool that they, you know,
Angel versus a little bit Demon.
Of that. So when they were,
it was a nice. There's so many biblical references in this: angels versus demons, light versus dark, Tower of Babel, all powerful being who's able to bend reality at his will. I guess maybe that's not too biblical. That's more of just referencing how powerful a deity is. Anyways.
Yeah, definitely. Speaking on the deity thing, like I was kind of shocked how many times Apocalypse was like, I am the true God or whatever. And like all of the other false gods or whatever. He was calling all of the other, religions basically false gods because he thought he was the true one. And it was just like, wow, that dude has some stones. Okay.
I mean, what was it like? And we first started this movie at Egypt, 3600 BCE. So like the dude's been around for a while, and kind of going back on your original thing, like at this point, he's already got almost all of like the powers that he needs to take over the world and be able to control everyone. Like he just needs mind powers in which he has to sleep for a while.
And it all depends on how fast you want it to happen. If you want a really fast, because I think, I don't know, I wasn't paying super close attention, but I think most of this happened within like a day or two. Like, I didn't like notice any like big time gaps there. It just all seemed like one after event after another. And I think he didn't really need Professor X's help because he already had some kind of plan in place. And then after Professor X and Magneto were talking, he was like, I think it was Angel, was like, what did you find? And he said, the solution. And it was like, oh, wow. Jeez. That's creepy. Okay.
He's a very...
Backing away there.
He's a very strange character. Like, they try setting him up as, like, a Thanos type of being, which I think in the comics, he's pretty much on that level of, like, I'm going to destroy the universe, but more of on a mutant level rather than...
Yeah.
Just, I don't know. I think maybe Thanos' grasp goes a little bit further. But
I think Thanos' backstory is way better. I mean, we get like the hype of Thanos over like five movies, you know, just like it's not just all at the beginning of one movie. And then like he has like Thanos, at least they gave like somewhat justifiable like logic behind his worldview. it wasn't just, you know, all the mutants must rise up and I'm gonna be king of the world. It's like, no, the universe only has so many resources, so we're gonna kill off half the people and I'm gonna go live on a farm. Like, I don't know, that feels like a little bit less like I'm evil to the core and more like I'm just like super really bad at thinking about things.
I would say, yeah, the cinematic universe Thanos is pretty well rounded and they had a whole lot more time to kind of develop him, where in the X-Men's universe is kind of like rushing out like different movies or whatever, trying to make sure that the actors still kind of look young or whatever. But along with that, it's kind of funny that you mentioned Thanos in regards to like he's a well-rounded character, because in the comics he basically does all this just because he wants to hook up with Death or wants to impress Death, who is an actual person. Death is a person. It's a feminine type of person that they kind of personify Death as, and he wants to impress Death so he can court Death, so he can marry Death, and it's just like, it's very weird. And also,
I haven't read the comments, the comics.
Yeah, no, I also haven't read. He's very much more basic, I'd say, in the comics in regards to like, I'm doing this because I want to impress Death. Where in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, it's like, no, there's actually a lot of cool things we can do with wiping out half of the universe with a snap. Like, you can cure a whole bunch of this stuff. Like, what happened? It's a whole, like, history of, I don't want what happened to me to happen to the rest of the universe, which is like, it's like good gone bad.
That's a good way to put it. Good gone bad.
In which I think Apocalypse is more of bad gone worse. Or maybe just bad gone bad.
Bad gone bad squared.
In which, like, that's kind of Eric as well. It's more of just like, Eric's like, all right, I guess I'm back in the bad saddle again. And then at the end of the movie,
so let's just kill the world.
JK, I'm good again. In which I think Eric's a really well-rounded character in regards to like, yeah, he flip-flops everywhere, but at least it makes him interesting instead of just like the character like Apocalypse, who's just like, I just want to kill people or control people. Like, okay.
Yep.
You have some control like complex.
Every bad guy ever.
Literally every bad guy.
So did you catch the Stan Lee cameo?
Him and his wife, I believe. I believe that's his wife that's in his arms.
Was that his wife?
Yeah. I think she passed away either a couple months or a year after that cameo.
Wow. Wow.
So it was very, I forgot.
Were there other Stan Lee in the X-Men universe? Was there other, you know?
That's a great question. I believe in X-Men 3, he makes a cameo. It's a famous cameo of him in a neighborhood with a hose, and the water, instead of going down, starts going up. He's just like, what's going on? It's pretty funny.
That's funny.
I totally forgot Stan Lee was in this, and when I saw him, I'm like, oh, Stan Lee.
That was the thought I had.
How have I forgotten about you, you beautiful soul?
Yeah, I know.
It was it was a bittersweet moment. Like, oh, that's right. You were here. Which is, it's good.
Yeah.
I don't know. I mean, very special that people like Stan Lee are able to write stories like this. I mean, I don't think he was directly related to X-Men in regards to like a lot of the characters. I think he was more an influential figure with, I think, the Fantastic Four and Spider-Man and maybe Iron Man. I forget. I'd have to do a little bit more research on that. But it's nice that they bring in Stan Lee, even though like he's kind of loosely related. Like maybe Jack Kirby or someone else made these characters, but they're like, hey, let's just get Stan Lee in here. Why not? It's the whole Leonardo DiCaprio meme of him pointing at the TV like, it's this guy.
Yeah. I don't know the meme, but I know the feeling. Oh, that's the guy from the thing. Yeah. I don't know. I think I'm running out of good things to say about this movie.
So, Nick,
we didn't have to, we didn't have to have the SR-71 Blackbird.
Yeah. I was really worried. Literally they blew it up for you.
When they showed it, I was like, oh no, here we go. This is going to be another 5 minutes of the podcast of me explaining why that's not any of this works. You're trying to be 80s, but you're not. It's just not working. And then they blew it up, and I was like, yes.
Which literally kills Havoc. Havoc explodes the X-Jet, exploding him. And somehow no one... I did want to ask, kind of segue into this, what was probably your favorite scene? I'm pretty sure I know what it is, but what was your favorite scene in this movie?
Can I say Quicksilver?
Or is that... Yeah, that's literally what I was probably segueing into.
Both of Quicksilver's scenes were perfect. Mm-hmm. I just love the idea of...
Yeah. Except this time of Time in a Bottle, awesome. It was Sweet Dreams, which is also a really fantastic choice for a song to kind of capture a lot of detail in a small time span. I mean, Sweet Dreams is maybe not a short song, but it fit pretty well with this in a way, right? Yeah. Very dreamish, totally. Like sequence of like scooping fish with like a cake cover. I forget what that's called, but it's like a thing that covers pastries.
The lady's just like,
or like the dog. He like grabs the dog, and the dog's got like the pizza, and it's like,
it's still eating. I don't know. So Quicksilver scene was great in the execution and all that, but like, really, are we gonna do all this coincidental timing that he showed up right when it was starting to just explode and he like felt it and like started to like start saving people?
I mean, it wasn't really that. It was more if he was quickly getting to Professor X so that he could talk, basically try to get to his dad.
Yeah.
And then ends up, he gets there at the perfect time because...
But like 30 seconds early or 30 seconds later, none of this would have worked.
No. No, I think that's the kind of the beauty of Quicksilver, right? You can kind of write him into any single moment that you want, right? Because he's quick.
Yep.
He's very quick, and he can get into any fraction of a second that you want to like do something with. Like, especially like kind of the scene that made my mind go like, those people would be dead is where the main lobby staircase room is and the ground starts like bulging upward.
Yeah,
and, like,
going up. The students are kind of just like standing
up. It's like, no, they would be kind of vaporized at least by their feet at this point if there's a giant explosion right below them. Like, that's a lot of energy.
Shockwaves.
The energy at least in the shockwave is going up before you get the heat effects or whatever. So you're going to get at least some reaction. So if anything, those poor people probably have some weird feeling legs. Or I don't know why. We also don't get the continuation of like whiplash, but like a whole lot of these people probably have whiplash. Because I don't think he held everyone's head back.
No, he was just tossing them out the window.
Literally. Which is kind of funny, right? Like it's a very cool visual effect of like him quickly going and then like quickly throwing, but then like it goes into like a slow-mo of like them slowly flying out the window or whatever. And then he's off going to somewhere else to save some other people.
Yeah.
But it's very creative.
Expert scene. Yeah.
I guess now you know why everyone built up the hype for WandaVision and why people were so excited over Pietro appearing. It's like, whoa, Peter's here. He's not supposed to be here, but he's here. And like, you now kind of get the hype of this guy's really cool. He's a really cool Quicksilver versus the one that we briefly got to see.
His name's Ralph Boner. He's not that cool.
I think there's a theory that technically Ralph Boner is actually he's under not house arrest, but the police are basically hiding his identity for some reason or whatever. So there's like a theory that it's actually Quicksilver from another universe or something like that. I don't know. That's WandaVision theory stuff.
Yeah.
But he's a really cool character, and you can kind of understand from watching both Days of Future Past and Apocalypse why people want to see this guy back as Quicksilver. And I think Marvel's probably teeing up pretty well for if they want to bring him back. And hopefully they do.
I wouldn't be opposed. From what I've seen about with Quicksilver, I would love to see a standalone Quicksilver movie. Like, just having him fix all of the world's problems would be kind of funny. You know, just having him giving food to all the hungry people in slow motion and, you know,
saving ham sandwiches.
It's just like, you know, saving everyone in the world. It's like Groundhog Day, but all over again, where like, you know, Eddie Murphy's character can, you know, go fix all the problems before they start happening.
Eddie Murphy.
Groundhog Day.
That's Bill Murray.
Bill Murray. See, I don't know actors.
I'm like Eddie Murphy. Eddie Murphy. That's Dr. Doolittle.
Oh, sorry. Wow, that was a tragic Oh wow, sorry.
No, that was pretty funny. I'm like,
move right past that one.
And this is why I'm the co-host, right, Nick?
This is why you are the co-host. I'm the court jester. For legal reasons, everything I've ever said is a joke. Oh, boy.
Oh, jeez.
Yeah.
What's your least favorite scene in this movie, Nick?
So can I only pick one?
You can only pick one. There's a lot of bad scenes in this movie.
Probably the whole opening scene of them trying to write in this big Dormammu character.
Dormammu,
I've come to bargain. It's like this beast, the big beast, the Thanos of this universe. And they're just going to write him in like 3 minutes at the very beginning of this movie. Like, really? So to be completely honest, everybody, I started watching this last night because I'm always prepared and up ahead.
I watched a week in advance. And I still remember all of it.
I know you did. You were Mr. Prepared. I was not. But I watched the first 3 minutes, 5 minutes maybe, whenever the end of that scene was. And I was just like, I can't watch this right now. I need to watch something more entertaining. So I ended up watching the rest of the movie today. Because nice. I could not finish it last night. I needed to watch something that wasn't going to make me yell at my phone all night. Because that is as bad as Emperor Palpatine. It's just like, yeah, Papa Palpatine's back. We needed a bigger bad guy because we killed the last one, and the other sidekick bad guy's kind of a dweeb. So, like, you know, we're going to make Palpatine the big, big, big bad guy now. It's just like, lazy writing, stop. Anyway, Palpatine, he was, what's his name? Apocalypse was giving me serious Palpatine vibes after he woke up. Actually, out of all the scenes with Apocalypse, the Palpatine scenes were probably my favorite. When he first came out of his tomb thing with his huge hood and his eyes were yellow and he's just walking around like, I'm evil. And then the shopkeeper guy's like, what are you gonna do? And then decapitates all his friends.
I don't really thinking about it now, I don't really get why he sees himself as an all-powerful being, but like, is maybe some of his brain kind of hardwired to like, oh, I need to survive, or if I want to enact my plan, I guess I need to cover myself and make sure that no one knows who I am, versus he just walks through the middle of Cairo or whatever, just killing people because he's like, you looked at me funny, dead. You looked at me weird. You're in the wall now. You're part of the ground. You're just dust. It's like... Like, he could have easily done that, but instead he chooses to, like, hide under a hood, which is very interesting.
Yeah.
And then finds Rogue. Or not Rogue. That's not Rogue. It's Storm. Storm. That's the character.
Oh. Yeah.
The Egyptian girl.
Yeah. She was the lady at the end who sliced his throat, right?
No, that's...
Did she have the pink sword or not? The pink, purpley lightning sword? Or was that the other lady?
Do you remember Days of Future Past with the one girl who was controlling the lightning and threw the X-Jet at the Sentinels during like the final fight?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. That's the same character as the girl that Apocalypse finds. And he's like, come with me. I'm going to tap into your potential and then you're going to be one of my horsemen. That's the same character, just... They actually provide her an origin story and made her, I guess, kind of interesting. But
Okay, cool. That's, I appreciate that. A little bit more backstory. I was always kind of curious how Professor X ended up the way he did.
Bald and in a chair.
In Logan. Exactly. Well, the chair part wasn't the problem, but like, so I've said this a million times. I've seen the first little few minutes of Logan, have not finished it yet. But I did know that Professor X was this decrepit guy whose migraines killed people. And so I was like, how on earth does this character who we saw, you know, Professor X was just, you know, the bastion of youth and, you know, super smart and intellectual. And I was like, oh, this is going to be an interesting character arc because I kind of already know an inkling of the ending and we're seeing where it's starting, what happens in between. And I think at the very beginning of the X-Men review here, I said that that Professor X was the character I was most looking forward to seeing develop, and I've not been disappointed. Watching Professor X develop has been really, really fun. He's required to be the leader, right? And it is something that he does extremely well, but yet you know he's just a broken man struggling with the same things that I do, right? Like, he has voices in his head, just like the other Mary Sue lady does. You know, it's like you learn how to control them. I'm sorry, I don't...
Mary Sue, I love it. Jean Grey.
Jean Grey. Okay, Jean Grey. The lady who, at the 11th hour in the 59th minute, she just goes off Phoenix mode and fixes everything. Like, whatever. Anyway, but like, he has a personal relationship with everyone, and he's just, you know, always the optimist, you know, thinking that humans and mutants can live together and being all optimistic. But yeah, seeing Logan and then Days of Future Past, like, what happens here? Like, we're kind of running out of movies. Like, what happens here? And so the beginning, I was like, man, I guess we're probably not going to get an answer this movie of how he gets bald and, you know, old looking and like sad. And I was not disappointed.
They shoehorn it in at the very end, you know, because he gets halfway through the assimilation process of almost becoming Apocalypse. His hair just falls out and then he's bald forever because of Apocalypse, I guess.
Hey, that wouldn't be the craziest thing I've watched in this movie. Specifically, the first 3 minutes would be the craziest thing I've watched this movie. Yeah, so anyway, that, but then also, like, the fact that he was, like, an extremely broken character in Logan, like, it shows that, like, he is not confident in anything. He does not want to really even have his powers anymore. He's just, like, is there another, I don't think there's another movie before Logan, right?
The next one we're watching is Logan. And I would say that's probably one of my favorite movies in this whole entire X-Men franchise, probably right next to Deadpool, which is the one after that we watch. So I guess we kind of leaked some of the movies that we're watching soon, Nick, but those are probably the favorite duo of X-Men movies that have come out in this whole entire series that I enjoy from this kind of snapshot of Marvel movies in the early 2000s, I guess, assuming that this goes on for decades and decades, I guess.
Yeah. So, yeah, just how broken that would make you if you realized that Thanos/Dormammu/the Apocalypse dude was using you to, like, hurt people, right? Because, like, his character is always the optimist. You know, there's always a way to fix it. There's always a way for people to work together and be better. And even he was being used to, you know, do really evil things. And he wasn't powerful enough to stop it. Because then I think in all the other movies, Professor X is like, okay, Logan might be literally physically invincible, but, like, plot armor-wise, Professor X always has the right answer for everything. You know, he's always the one who swoops in the last minute and fixes it. And, you know, always has the right line to say to the right character to get them motivated to do the right thing at the end. You know, but this time, you know, it shattered that whole, you know, he can fix it. And they had Mary Sue do it because, you know, Mary Sue. But, we had, I think that was really exciting. And
it was a more humanizing, like, moment, right? They kind of made him less invincible. They made him a lot more malleable as a character and as a person, right? Because near the end of the movie, he's basically ready to give up. He's so tired and so distraught. He's like, I'm done. I'm dying. Apocalypse is going to win. I'm done. And then Jean comes in and saves the day, in which it's like, okay, cool. I mean, we get some cool visuals. We get an introduction.
Hey, I'm glad Mary Sue saved the day, for the record, but it's just like, come on, Jean. Phoenix all now? Okay. Whatever.
I wanted to ask, what did you think of the kind of surprise cameo in this movie that I didn't expect when I first watched this movie? Of Weapon X appearing, the great Wolverine, in which quite literally Kurt, I guess Nightcrawler, Jean and Scott stumble upon at Stryker's facility in the hills, and they somehow find him, and it's like, oh hey, it's Hugh Jackman.
Yeah. Well, first off, I was really confused, but secondly, I'll tell you what I was thinking firstly. Because this is making sense. The sentence is not running in circles at all. as soon as they're like, oh, they have some kind of animal in there. and in this big box. And I was like, oh, either it's going to be some huge beast we've never seen, or it's going to be Logan. And as soon as I saw the feet, I was like, oh, huge Jackman, yay. Oh boy, that was kind of fun to have that little slow reveal and then like, oh yay, it is him. But like, all right, all the questions though are starting now. What the heck is going on with him? Why did he have the thing on his head? What was up with the little thingies? Were they trying to like extract something from him? Were they trying to turn him into like just a soldier beast thing? Where that what was the deal?
So his also, whole what's up with the military, like appearance.
Dude? How did he just swoop in with the helicopter and like capture all the? I'm.
This is the most confusing part of the movie as well to me as well. Like, okay, thank you. I just repeat myself. So with Days of Future Past, I put a whole big spotlight on the very end scene of like, oh, and then Stryker gets Logan out of the water. But then his eyes glow yellow, which means it's Mystique. And you're like, okay, so Mystique has Logan. What's going to happen? But then we get to this movie. Mystique doesn't have Logan. Stryker has Logan. So then what was that last scene? Days of Future Past. Where like, was it Mystique? I guess it was. But then she kind of just gave Logan to Stryker, which then just makes her a terrible character in that regard of like, she just gave away Logan. Or I guess maybe it was inevitable. I think that's maybe the case that he's making is like, it's inevitable that Logan got captured by Stryker. And I think this is more of them trying to repair X-Men Origins, right? Because they're trying to, they're trying to fix the fact that like, oh, X-Men Origins wasn't really a good movie. We really butchered Deadpool in that. We need to make a better way of like introducing Weapon X, in which people kind of know how Wolverine became Weapon X. But
wait, is Wolverine Weapon X or is Deadpool Weapon X?
Wolverine is Weapon X.
Okay, well, I believe, that from here, but like in the future, does Weapon X become? Because I thought Weapon X was Deadpool last time.
Right? I believe Deadpool is the evolution of Weapon X. So Weapon X, I think I mentioned in the previous podcast, like the whole Weapon X initiative is Stryker trying to recreate a Captain America like soldier that he can control. And he does so with many different ideas with chemicals and materials.
Stryker, the guy who was on the helicopter?
Stryker was the guy on the helicopter. If you remember, he was kind of the old guy who basically walks like 1,000 miles at the end of Origins because the mind control lady made him walk a whole bunch and then the military stops him.
Yeah.
So that's him, but then in, was it Days of Future Past, he was the one dude who tried tasing, he did tase Mystique, but then Logan or someone else stopped him, but then Logan had his whole like PTSD scene. And then now he's back again in Days of Future Past where he successfully gets Logan. He successfully has this whole entire operation. He captures all these mutants, but then of course, because of Nightcrawler, Jean, and Scott, they save Weapon X, cause a whole bunch of chaos because, of course, Weapon X, being Logan, is just going to kill everyone in his way and then escape into the woods, never to be seen again until...
yeah, it's just until it's convenient for the plot. I was thinking he was going to come in and help the end fight with Apocalypse.
But nah, he was a cameo and that was it. It was, hey, I'm here. And I'm gone.
Oh, it's that guy from the other movie.
It's almost like Iron Man appearing like in a Spider-Man movie. Like, oh, it's Iron Man. It's Iron Man, guys. Look, it's Iron Man. And then that's it.
There you go. Congrats.
Or actually, no. It's very much like, I would say it's almost like WandaVision, right? They put Quicksilver in. It's like, it's Quicksilver. It's Quicksilver. Yeah. And then gone. And you're like,
does it mean anything to the plot? No.
Okay. Not really, besides...
I guess he kind of helps everybody escape. Yeah,
he helps everyone escape because he kills a whole bunch of guards and sets the whole facility on red alert. But I thought that was a fun scene, kind of like tying in Hugh Jackman and being able to do that. And then they kind of pay homage to like the original trilogy with when Wolverine is leaving, he hears Patrick Stewart's voice, kind of guiding him away.
What that voice was.
Yeah, that's the future, what's it called? Future Professor X. If you remember the old guy in the wheelchair that we see in Logan, that's him. Basically saying, run Logan or go somewhere or something like that. And then Jean kind of gives the exposition of, I gave him a piece of his past and he just ran with it or something like that. But his past was his future that he was listening to.
His future. Yeah. Okay.
Whole scene was kind of paying homage to the fact that here's where we kind of start with Logan is in X-Men 1. He's in like a Arctic scene or wherever doing some cage fighting or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And then he gets introduced to Professor X later. And it kind of ties the bow on his character with, oh, he's going into the frozen tundra, but of course, like, this is like years before the first X-Men comes out, so it's more of, I don't know, he wanders around the woods for a while, I guess. I don't know.
Yeah.
But I'd say it's more of like, it's a great way of making the character forget who they are, right? Because last time we saw Wolverine, he knew everything besides confronting Professor X at the end of the movie saying, I don't remember anything since the White House.
Yeah.
And it's like, oh, okay, well, let's brief you on everything that happened. And so now it's kind of just like, I don't have any memories. Okay, well, all right. Yeah, I don't know.
Interesting.
It was an interesting addition to this movie. I think it was a nice way to tie in the character that kind of kickstarted this whole series. Pay homage to him, in which then he gets his own movie right after this.
Yeah,
and then just
Logan.
Yeah, I'm not gonna spoil anything else, but man,
yeah,
what a movie!
It was a good movie.
As far as
the two characters we're talking about, everything relating to Apocalypse and the greater plot.
Three characters. You liked Eric. You like Professor X.
Oh, okay, yeah,
Professor X and Logan. Yeah. And I guess you kind of like Nightcrawler a little bit.
Yeah.
What did you think of Olivia Munn?
Who's that?
She is oh goodness, I totally forgot her name already. She is the one girl in the Psylocke. She's Psylocke, the one girl who has the purple sword, who has very, very tight clothing, and her whole initiation into the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse is, all right, you get to wear spandex now.
I didn't really notice her character all that much, unfortunately, so I have no idea who you're talking about. Is the lady who sliced What's-His-Face's neck at the end?
I think so, yeah, but then it's revealed that it's actually Mystique or whatever.
Yeah. Oh, you're right, yeah, it totally was Mystique. Yeah. Anyway, no specific opinion about her. I kind of forgot she existed. The only thing I would say, though, is when Mystique, who was looking like this lady... was slicing his neck, it wasn't until after she sliced his neck, like I thought it was over, like after she sliced his neck, and then I remembered, oh yeah, that beginning scene I was trying to forget about, that's when he got the instant healing power, and I'm like, oh bummer,
dang it,
his neck was healing back. I was like, dang it, you were close, good try Mystique. So close.
She actually, I guess fun fact about this lady, IRL, she worked for a company called G4, which was a TV show about video games and other pop culture stuff on, was it? I forget what the specific program was that it aired on. Was it X? I forget. But yeah, so she came from, or at least she worked on G4 or whatever, which reminded me of you because you became popular with the cube that you made, which also I think has the name G4, right?
Yeah, it does. Yeah. Yep.
So... Oh, just
interesting. Well, I didn't nothing of note there, unfortunately. So I appreciate you pointing that out, but sorry I didn't pick up on that.
You don't know who she is. You have no clue who she is, and you're like, "This is a random character that I don't care about." I have no clue who
any of these people are. Exactly. Unfortunately, that's with most of the stuff in this universe. Yeah. As far as like the final boss fight, like, whatever.
You have a whole bunch of metal trying to hit him, and it's just a force field. And it's like, and it's just like,
and no one accidentally gets nicked by a piece of flying metal this entire time.
No, and then you got Cyclops shooting his eye beams out, and no one gets nicked by that either.
Yeah. It's just like, okay, yeah.
And then you get I don't know who else. Oh, Storm then comes in at the very end with her lightning powers, which I think ultimately cripples him or whatever. I think it's a really cool visual effect thing at the very end of like him kind of basically disintegrating. It's very, I'd say it's very Age of Ultron. If you remember,
I was gonna say it was very Palpatine-y.
In a way, yeah. I mean, was it the Episode 9 of Star Wars? We'll probably maybe get to that at some point in the future. It's very, yeah. I mean, you have Rey with the dual lightsabers blocking the lightning, and it's kind of the same with this, except Apocalypse isn't shooting out anything. It's just a whole bunch of people shooting things at him, and then he dies.
You're just kind of like melting away to the skeleton, and then it's like, yuck. Oh, well.
Yeah. Ugh. So, I don't know. Interesting scene. Watching that, I'm like, all right, here's the moment where the bad guy dies. The end.
Yeah, the end.
It was probably the one.
Now the world's all better now. And I love how, like, the little newsreels they play at the end, it's like, world leaders are happy that the mutants have saved us once again from the mysterious and all-powerful Dormammu character. Also, it looks like Magneto's still a good guy. Mike, this is at the end of the show, so I'm pretty sure anyone who's hearing this part will know what we're talking about. Are you available to record EV tomorrow morning?
I saw the text.
Drew's asking me.
I'll get to it at some point. I'll let you know. I'm going to finish up this review of X-Men Apocalypse.
So, a final. Where's this going?
Like, yeah, so it's gonna go to Logan. So we're going to Logan next. Where do you do you think this is going to influence Logan? Do you think we're going to see any characters from this movie in Logan, or do you think I don't know what if there was a sequel to this movie in which I guess full not really spoiler territory, but at least being totally clear with you. The next movie after this, if you want to stay canonical, or not canonical, but like with these characters, there is another movie called X-Men Dark Phoenix, which is basically the exploring of Jean Grey as Dark Phoenix, or the Phoenix.
Dark Phoenix? She becomes bad now? Oh, no.
You got it.
Can't handle you literally deciphered Mary
the
Sue.
Plot. You deciphered the plot from just the title.
All right, great. We'll review Dark Phoenix on this show right now. I don't like it. I'm sorry. I haven't seen it, but I don't like it.
You know, what's pretty funny is I haven't watched the movie. I've seen, again, I've probably name-dropped them before, CinemaSins, the people at CinemaSins, fantastic ways of reviewing movies by giving it like a sin counter or whatever, and giving arbitrary sin counts to certain things in the movie. They did a great job reviewing this, and it was just like, this is not a good movie. What would you want to see as a sequel to this movie instead of a movie that you haven't seen, which is Dark Phoenix? Like, what would you want to see with these characters next?
Well, Magneto is probably the one I'm most curious about, because it seems like he was, in this movie, he was still in trouble from the White House incident, and I don't see how he wouldn't get in trouble for the Auschwitz incident, and possibly, you know, the Sydney, Australia incident, and the New York City incident, and all of the other incidents that he caused around the world. So honestly,
everywhere he goes.
Exactly, pretty much. Like, even the entire world, pretty much. I don't know. I would be curious to see if society welcomes him back in. And if they did, I'd be kind of confused as to why. But I'd want to see that take place on the silver screen. Professor X, I think I kind of know where it's going with Logan here. I think I'm pretty much set to, you know, see Logan in the broken state. Or sorry, not Logan. Professor X in the broken state of that he was in the movie Logan.
As you're going to be watching this movie with a whole different lens, and it's going to be fantastic to get
your
review.
I will be. And I'm actually going to finish it, because the power's not going to go off in the theater halfway through. Yes. And me and my friend aren't going to be like, oh, this is a violent movie, let's leave. I don't know. As far as like all the other characters, I could kind of care less if it's not Quicksilver. I don't know. Mystique, I guess. I don't know, see what she's up to, but like, they kind of hype her up to be this like huge hero of every single mutant ever. I'm just kind of like, really? All right, well, I guess. I don't know, whatever. So maybe a little bit more on Mystique, but overall though, I guess I wasn't even really wanting this movie, and so I wouldn't really even want a sequel to this one. Besides the Professor X discontinuity, I'm not from my perspective of only seeing what maybe 5 or 6 of these X-Men movies, and we're definitely skipping around, I would probably say I don't think this one needed to exist, and also the sequel probably doesn't need to exist either. I think Logan would be sufficient to close it up for me, and I don't know. This was not a good movie. It felt like they're like, okay, we have to make 2 more of these movies. What are we gonna do? And they sit down, and the writer's like, oh, we could have them. I don't know. Nuke Russia and the U.S. and like tear the White House apart. Oh, okay, that's a great idea. Let's make that movie. And they made the movie, and then like two years later, they came back and like, all right, what are we gonna do next? It needs to be bigger and better and even bigger. Like, we could have this character that no one has known about and just have him be the ultimate bad guy. I don't know.
I can already tell you might enjoy Deadpool, like, because they definitely address a lot of the stuff in these movies.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Okay. You're going to love, because Deadpool is very much like, they use these movies as the butt of a joke. Just like, ha! Like, the world just explodes every single time that the X-Men do something. Like, come on, guys.
Try not to tear up the entire universe.
Yeah, come on. Yeah. So, I think you might enjoy, after watching a lot of these movies, that you didn't see in a favorable light, at least from the score that you gave Apocalypse, along with Days of Future Past. It's only going to make, I'd say, Deadpool a lot more funnier, because it just plays on the tropes of these movies of like, oh, okay, it's all serious. Nah. Nah.
Boy. Well, I'm looking forward to it. I've seen a lot of memes from Deadpool, so I'm looking forward to catching all those memes and understanding what they're about.
Probably one of my favorite superheroes, just because he's very silly. But we'll get there when we get there. We still have one last serious movie to get through. And
we totally do.
Probably going to be my favorite. It is my favorite in the whole X-Men franchise. But,
you know, what I will say about Apocalypse, unfortunately, the emperor of the entire everything about all of the mutants, his groove was kind of off. I think the emperor needed a new groove. That's how we're ending the show. See you guys later. Have a good one.
Bye.